All right, very good morning everyone. Welcome back for Proteomic Data Analysis Project presentations. Today we have following presenters: Akore, Venkata Fani, Harshvardhan, Jishnu, and Devargya. Before we start the presentations, let me just remind you for the assignment which all of you do. Please make sure that, you know, when we are giving you assignment forms, you are filling the summary write-up with some sentences which you write, what is your understanding of those write-up. Just don't try only MCQ questions, but also write few summary statement. Otherwise, some of you who are leaving it blank, we cannot give you any marks for that. So you have to make sure that you are writing at least your summary statement, what you understand from that in the given field. It's not descriptive writer, but at least, you know, one or two lines what we are asking in those questions. So that general announcement. With this, let me start with the first presenter, Akore, who is going to talk about non-functional pituitary adenomas and using the proteomics data followed by implementing with machine learning approaches, what type of classifiers could be identified. So that will be interesting to learn from Akore. So we are starting the first presentation now.
Hello everyone. My name is Akore. I am a PhD research scholar from CRNTS Department, IIT Bombay. My project topic is deep proteomics analysis of non-functional pituitary adenomas versus control samples for identification of classifiers through machine learning approach. Overview. So in overview, actually, I mentioned that which topic today I'll tell. That is, first of all, literature survey, then data analysis based on meta-analysis. Then I'll go for the machine learning model using the platform of Orange. Then pathway analysis using ReactOM. Finally, conclusion and future scope of work. Literature review based on non-functional pituitary adenomas. So pituitary gland is formed from the adenohypophysis, that is the anterior pituitary, and the neurohypophysis, that is posterior pituitary. NFP is a common tumor occurs in the pituitary gland. Non-functional pituitary adenoma is highly heterogeneous with different hormone expression subtypes. No symptoms in the early stage. Clinically, non-functional pituitary adenomas account for 14.7% of all pituitary adenomas. NMPA causes headaches, visual problems, or pituitary hormone deficits. Now, coming to the data analysis, I have taken this paper for the literature survey, because how they have taken their data and they actually came up, how they actually done the data analysis, that is the reason I have actually surveyed this paper. So now they have taken the 11 tissue samples based on basically three were controls, four were non-invasive non-functional pituitary as adenomas, and four were invasive NFPs. So they, for the data analysis perspective, they have set the threshold for the p-value less than 0.05, absolute FCs greater or equal to 2. So these are the basically the volcano plot. They have done this volcano plot for finding out the significant proteins. Now, intentionally, I have mentioned this GH1 to understand, and finally, when I will tell the data, is there any common gene I am getting or not. So this is the reason I have mentioned this differentially expressed in GH1 in the data, in this particular paper, which they got in that particular paper. Now, why metabo-analysis? That is the reason I actually gone through this paper. So basically, we can find that metabo point of view has the superiority. So we can explore different things in the advanced meta-analysis. That is the reason I have taken this particular paper for the for the literature survey. So now we can see that biomarker analysis also can be possible in that particular advanced meta-analysis. For meta-analysis 4 point of view, we can see that it can possible. So now we are dealing meta-analysis 5. So obviously we are getting much more this kind of tool in the particular meta-analysis 5. Now, after why meta-analysis in our case for finding out the significant proteins in our data sets. So now after getting the significant protein based on some features, based on some, practically based on some differentially expressed proteins or according to their top 10 or top 15 proteins or 20 proteins. So finally, we should come up, we should develop some model in some, but using some programming environment or something like any new platform. So for me, it was new because I dealt with programming part, but not dealt the particular platform that is Orange for machine learning model, for the machine learning development of machine learning models. So that is why actually I have taken that that particular software for development of the machine learning model for my data set. Now, for Orange, actually, why Orange? This is the reason that there are multiple toolboxes are available. Now, these are the data management and pre-processing is possible, classification is possible, regression, clustering, projections, all these things are possible. So that is the reason we can take our data set, the significantly expressed proteins, into the particular this platform for building up the model. Now, though I studied those two papers, but I need to understand that how basically this thing happened. So for that, I have surveyed these two papers. One is completely based on the mass spec data set of the COVID severe and non-severe. The authors have taken this 74 samples based on the COVID severe and non-severe. And they actually got the basically the differentially expressed proteins based on the criteria of the p-value less than 0.05. And SARPINS is one of the significant term actually we are hearing at this point of time. So they got also the SARPINS from the data analysis perspective. Now, after getting that, they have selected the most significant proteins based on the VIP score. Or take this forward. Some proteins they wanted to take the forward based on the VIP score and fit the develop the model in Orange 3. So this is the reason. So they have compared different model like random forest, logistic regression, naive base, k nearest neighbor, and as well as SGA. Finally, they got the best because of the some parameters. They came up with that SGM is the best classifier. So now, as the classification accuracy was almost 0.88 and AUC was found to be more than 0.9. These are the parameters. So they have taken another paper which is surveyed based on the microarray, because my intention was to just to go through that machine learning model part. So they have taken 10 proteins. Now, they initially started with the SGM because it's a very popular model. So they have taken this, but they actually taken the AUC parameter. So what can be the AUC parameter? That is my most interesting part. This is the reason. So they have the paper based on the glioma. So for that, there are different grades of glioma they have built based on the microarray assays. But practically, the AUC was very important part for me. So how they came up with the AUC? So AUC point of view, 0.9 they got for the healthy control versus this grade 2 glioma. And then AUC point of view, AC versus healthy control versus grade 2 point of view, they got AUC 1. And finally, AC versus grade 4 glioma point of view, 0.975. AUC perspective, I actually taken these two papers, this particular paper. Now, this is practically, now I want to say something about the normal data analysis workflow. For that, basically the MaxQuant data usually provided, then definitely we basically feed it to the metabo. But before that, at least, is there any kind of missing values there or not that can be, that we can see based on the data itself in the CSV. So then, but definitely this is a trend. So we usually feed the data into the metabo analysis. Now, if there is any kind of missing value, then only we proceed into that direction for the missing value imputation, otherwise normal proceeding. But fine, before that, whatever I'm saying based on the raw data analysis, but whenever we go for the differentially expressed protein, all these things, then definitely require for the sample-to-sample variation. So sample-to-sample analysis, for that point of view, definitely we need some normalization. This thing is very important. So normalization, we need to normalize our data set. So different normalization strategies are available in different platforms. But here we can see this is a kind of a normalized the density plot. So there are two time plots usually preferred to see whenever we think that our data is properly normalized or not. One is density plot and one is blocks plot. Now, finally, after normalizing the data, usually go for the significant protein, the differentially expressed protein. So for that, obviously, this thing that is called the volcano plot, that is important. So after volcano significant protein we get, now it is our call how we can take our feature forward. Should we take some top 20 or 50 differentially expressed proteins, or we should go some in a different way? So in my case also, I have taken VIP score for that. So that is why I mentioned this VIP score. Now, after that, the data should be taken forward for the machine learning modeling of the machine, particularly building of model in the machine learning platform that is on it. This is particularly the data analysis work. Now, coming to the data pre-processing. Now, when we actually feed the data, that raw data, so which have been provided for the NFP and the control. So there you can see that there are two groups. It should be two groups. It is also showing the two groups are detected. Next, imputation, that 0% missing value was there. So already I know from the CSV file itself, there is no missing value at all. Now, still, it is the normal approach that when I feed the data into Metaverse, it is giving me the result like the 0% missing value was there. It's okay, so written, but as no missing value is there, so normal way I should proceed. After proceeding, definitely I actually skip some portion here. Why PCS is important here? Because I actually got, this is a kind of an outlier. After this cluster, we can see that this is a kind of an outlier. And from the CSV point of view, I can easily find it out that which is the outlier because of this percentage PC1 I know. So now, it is very easy to discard one outlier, one sample from the data set, and we can think this is the kind of a cluster where one sample is discarded. It is a very easy to, but biology is already done in a very, it's a kind of a tedious job. So they have done that. So we should recheck that. Is there any possibility or not? So what I have done, I actually taken that particular CSV itself and I check the samples of sample to sample. I know that that NFP 11 has this kind of problem, but still I need to recheck it. So I think Pearson correlation coefficient, if I find it out and if it's less than 0.5, then at least I can think that now at least I must more sure on that yes, now I can at least discard one sample out of that. And finally, I got that basically these two clusters, these clusters. So that this is the reason I actually checked the Pearson sample to sample correlation, and the Pearson correlation I found out, and below 50, as this is below 50%, that is the reason I discarded that. Now coming to the normalization technique. Normalization is very important because I already mentioned that as far as right now, whatever I said based on the raw data analysis, but now this is the high time to go for the differential expressed proteins. For that, normalization is very important. So there are different strategy normalization can take, but for mass spec, usually prefer the median normalization. Median normalization, log transform, obviously log transform should be there, otherwise you cannot get kind of like a Gaussian plot. We always get this kind of skewed plot. Only this kind of a logarithmic conversion, you can expect this kind of a Gaussian plot. Now coming to the density plot point of view, you can see this is very much normalized. So now I can think it forward for the other data analysis approach like fold chain, what is the fold chain criteria. So fold chain point of view, it is data analysis who is dealing the data. It's completely, it's his call. Now, basically I have said for the FC per point of view two, but finally, usually 1.2, 1.5, several cases, usually researcher for the data analysis, they usually do this 1.5. But in my case, I have taken this two. Now, we can see there is this upregulated 535 and 279. My interest is really for the volcano plot. Now, coming to the p-test, also p-value, because for fold chain, threshold given as two, p-value is separated. Separately, I am giving this kind of thing, and significant protein, I got 1029, and unequal variance is quite possible because of the looking at the data set itself, we can say this is the unequal. Now, p-test is also performed. Now, coming to the, this is the most important, but here actually, we are actually imposing both the criteria together, where p less than 0.05 as well as this FC. So, both, if we impose these two things together, we can expect this upregulated, downregulated protein. How many? So, I got 357 and 241, and every time I downloaded this particular report for getting the idea. Now, why I mentioned at that point of view, every time I, at this point of time, actually tried to analyze the data set from the one paper which I already surveyed. So is there any common thing, common protein I'm getting or not? So this is the reason I surveyed that. So in my case also, GH1, I'm finding that this is downregulated. So now it is clearly observed this is downregulated, as this is NFP and this is control. So it is downregulated. And their case also, they also got it in the downregulated. This is actually one of the findings which I got. Now, this is protein somatotropin and GH1, and I got it from the UniProt access. Now this is the heat map. So from heat map point of view, you can see that this is the basically the segregated properly. The DEPs are segregated properly from the heat map itself. Now coming to the VIP plot, so VIP, why VIP? Because I already mentioned, so some features I should take it forward for the machine learning model. So here actually I have mentioned, actually I have taken 15 features for take it forward for my machine learning model. So these are basically the accession ID, but I actually access this in UniProt and find it out that what are the proteins and the genes from the UniProt itself. Now coming to the machine learning, because this part is important, because here actually what I have done, I actually taken all this model and feed the data. So this is the way that normalized data set usually take for feeding up the value in the particular file section, and then these are in CSV format. Now coming to the different model, we have to take some parameters out of that. So now one thing that is the stacking, because in stacking part actually we are taking all the inputs from the this different model. Now finally test and score, from this test and score point of view, we can find it out the different parameters, and we should take the call which one we should take it forward for the classification model. Now ROC is also important at the parameter, says that how I can see the curve basically. So this is actually a model which I have developed in the orange. Now these are the parameters. These parameters are important, the area under the curve. I already mentioned that in papers also, which I have actually surveyed initially. Classification accuracy, F1, precision and recall, all these things are important. But here we can see the AOC is remain the sometimes same, like in stacking, like this logistic regression. But definitely we should take some another parameter like CA, classification accuracy. So classification accuracy point of view, you can see this is more or less lesser than this one. So this is the reason. And from SVM point of view, you can see the AOC is lesser than this. So at least one model we should take it forward for, or should select as per as the all the parameters. So now I think I already have mentioned that basically the classification accuracy and under area under the curve point of view, I have taken the logistic regression. So of the my basically my classifier. Now AOC point of view, this area is very important. So now I already ROC point of view. So ROC point of view, this area is very important. So now ROC point of view, I want to check in a different class point of view. So there is an option of the defining the class. So 0 and 1 means in my case 0 is control, 1 is this kind of a disease, which I already mentioned, means NFPs and the control samples. So now you can see that this is the, basically it's giving various area for different part, means different samples. This kind of model. So now different model point of view are getting different area. Now, but still area point of view, as I already mentioned that here also you can see that the area point of view, this logistic regression is giving best result, and also I mentioned the classification accuracy is also important in that part. So classification accuracy and area point of view, still it is basically the best model. This is called the logistic regression. Now again for this part as well, this is the practically this target class we have selected for the disease part. Here also you can see this particularly, this is the thing, and here also the superiority goes to the logistic regression. Because of every time I'm mentioning, though AUC differently, different and area differently, but still every time I'm mentioning that particular classification accuracy. For that, it is basically I'm getting this particular logistic. This is the best model. Now coming to the pathway analysis. So for pathway analysis, I have used ReactOM for different pathways. So which are the different pathways that I found from the ReactOM, and overall data set which I got after the normalization happened, and this basically differentially expressed. So for that actually fit to that particular pathway analysis, I actually wanted to take this pathway analysis, what are the important pathways, top regulated pathways. So for that ReactOM actually help me to get all these top-degraded pathways. And it is found that the peptide hormone biosynthesis, the upregulation, its mode is upregulation. And these are the basically the top-degraded pathways which I found from the pathway analysis. Now, though more pathways I found, but I mentioned this for upregulation point of view, this many pathways I mentioned, but downregulated pathway also, these pathways I found from the reactome itself. So these are the basically pathway point of view I have taken the help from the reactome. Now, basically, this is my conclusion slide that what I have done. So practically, I've taken the samples, 53 samples of NFP and controls I've taken for the data analysis. Now, I already shown that one outlier I found and how actually I dealt the outlier in a different way. One is the PCI approach, and then I also dealt with that particular CSV normal Excel sheet approach, what I have done. Then how many proteins I got as the top regulated means upregulated and downregulated, that I also shown based on the criteria which I imposed as the fold change and p-value. Then obviously I found the proteins which I found based on the accession IDs that I also found. And finally, top 15 proteins I taken forward for the, that is based on the DIP score to build up the model. Then obviously logistic regression I found that the best model because of the, I already mentioned that AUC classification accuracy, those are the very much important and those values given the best result in that particular logistic regression. So I came up, this is the best classifier for my data set. Now pathway analysis I performed using, though I told very little, basically very briefly in pathway analysis, and using the reactome actually helped me to get the upregulated or downregulated pathways. And finally, I mentioned these two, basically these two pathways, those were upregulated and top upregulated and downregulated. Now this part is future work, and why I mentioned that, because practically I dealt, I found that initially I started with MetaBoat, then I taken the all the data set of the differential express proteins, and then selected some practically these things of VIP score, imposing VIP score, then again changing into the orange. So it is the reason I thought that, as I am also, I know R, so I thought in my future with this data set, I think I can come up with a single algorithm where I can think that from the data, raw data itself, it will start to able to read the data set. And finally, this bioconductor is a very important package for this particular analysis of the proteins, this mass spec data point of view. And this bioclite I also surveyed, I also actually started to work on that. But definitely I will come up with some the same classifier, because already I done these things like differential express, which are the differential express proteins, because after imposing this criteria like p-value and fold change. So imposing the same concept remain the same, but I need to come up with the single program, one program I will write, and finally I want to come up with the this kind of, at least I can expect that logistic regression will give me the best output over here also. So this is the reason I think this can be a can be my future work, that where I start from beginning till end, which I showed today, that will be done through R. So this is the thing, this is the future plan of the work. And finally, obviously, thanks to Professor.
All right. RQ, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I think very nice presentation, very informative, lot of details and discussion you have given. Only major constraint is that you have exceeded the time. Okay. Nevertheless, I think let me discuss a couple of points for you. So the first question is, like, when you do literature review and you try to compare two different methodologies in mass spectrometry based and microarray based, and try to come up with that both AUCs you are looking at from both the methods, right? So just based on your reading and looking at different data which you have analyzed, what will be your recommendation if you were to do the machine learning approaches? Whether the strategies will be same whether you take the mass spec based data set or micro data set, or whether something else has to be also thought of while dealing with this type of data?
Sir, practically, I think for mass spec and micro data set point of view, finally, the whichever I told regarding the differentially expressed proteins which I found, that will remain the same as far as the concept which I actually incorporated in the practically Metabo. And then the next part is also that remain the same, because that you also mentioned that, sir, they have taken in micro data paper, they have taken only 10 proteins and then feed into the model. So directly, sir, whenever we go for the orange approach, so the strategy remain the same, but definitely the experimental assess point of view, that might be different. But sir, I want to go in this direction only, which I also followed for the mass spec. And if I come up with some micro data set, I will also go through into this direction only, sir.
All right. So I agree with your assessment in that way. Let me take you another question. So you have tried different approaches, and you got actually quite a bit large number of proteins, right, which looks pretty good to you. And then you selected 15 of those as a part of your VIP score. Can you name me top three proteins which you identified?
Practically, sir, I actually mentioned that in the slide, actually. So basically, I checked in UniProt also, but that is the reason. But sir, GH1 and somatotropin point of view, I can still tell, because that I checked in that actually for literature point of view, I actually surveyed that and compared it.
So that's it. I think in a lot of data, we should not lose the significance of the data, because, you know, after all this work, finally, you should at least recall that what are those top leads, right? In terms of your pathway analysis, when you showed from Reactome, which was not too much expected from this project, but still you showed that data. I think your second and third pathway hits were quite, strange in some way, because that were linked to Leishmaniasis infection. So how will you justify that in the, non-functional pituitary adenomas? There are some pathways, the timer is up for you, by the way. So what are the pathways which are linked to Leishmania? How will you defend that?
Sir, basically, I just checked into Reactome. So just I wanted to come up with that particular pathways, but sir, actually, I didn't go that much in depth for that particular, in the biological perspective, I didn't actually go through that. So basically, sir, definitely I will check that in that after your advice.
Look at which proteins are mapping, and maybe one or two of those proteins are also linked to the Leishmaniasis disease infection for some reason. And that's what is trying to pull that as the main pathway, right? So, yeah, so I think, a lot of the explanation which you have given was very nice. A lot of information were there. At the end of a project, at least some takeaway should be there, as not only methodology per se, but also the biology part of it. What main leads you have identified, what main pathways have come forward, and does that make any sense, right? All right, so overall, very good presentation. So let me move on to the next presenter now.
Thank you, sir.
All right, so now let's move on to the next presenter by Venkata Fani regarding COVID project on non-severe and severe swab samples using machine learning approaches, how to understand the host responses for the disease pathogenesis. All right, so let's start this presentation now.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Ayappu Venkatapandi Vamsinath, a final year undergraduate student from Computer Science and Engineering Department. My project is on global proteomics analysis of COVID non-severe versus COVID severe swab samples, the machine learning approach to decipher the host response towards COVID pathogenesis. This is a table of contents. First, we start with brief introduction to COVID, and then we move on to data analysis, which is a main part of our project. And then we go to literature review, and then we finish off with references. Introduction. COVID-19 is a contagious disease caused by severe acute respiratory syndrome coronavirus 2, also known as SARS-CoV-2. The first case was identified in Wuhan, China, in December 2019. the disease has spread worldwide, leading to the current pandemic. As of October 15, 2021, 24 crore cases were reported and 5 crore deaths were confirmed all over the world. Symptoms. I think most of you know all the symptoms. If it's a mild disease, cough, fever, fatigue, and headache are generally known symptoms. If it is a little more severe, then you may also have loss of smell and taste. If it is more severe, then it may also lead to breathing difficulties. As of July 2021, there are 4 dominant variants of SARS-CoV-2, alpha variant, which is also known as UK variant. Beta variant is known as South African variant. Gamma variant is known as Brazilian variant. And Delta variant is known as Indian variant. COVID-19 is most known to affect the respiratory tract, starting from sinuses, nose, throat, all to the lungs. The lungs are the most affected organ because virus accesses the host cells via enzyme angiotensin converting enzyme to ACTU, which is most abundant on the surface of the lungs. Various other parts are also affected, like nervous system, gastrointestinal tract, cardiovascular system, and other organs like kidneys, etc. Prevention measures. I think most of you know, and it will be just a repetition. Wear mask and maintain social distance in public places. Avoid crowded places and indoors as much possible. Clean your hands regularly, either with soap or a sanitizer. Get yourself vaccinated as quick as possible. This is the project workflow. The output file of the MaxQuant software is provided to us. That is given as an input for Metabo Analyst, and output of Metabo Analyst is used in Orange. The outputs of Metabo Analyst and Orange is used in ReactMM stream. Description of our dataset. The sample size of the dataset is 21, out of which 10 were COVID severe and 11 were COVID non-severe. There were total 3,749 proteins with 57.7% of missing values. For missing values imputation, first, all the proteins with greater than 50% of missing values were filtered, and then KNN feature-wise KNN is used as missing value imputation. And then the data set is normalized by median and log transformed to get the graph given in the right side. You can see in the graph that before normalization, it was completely biased, and after normalization, it was spread throughout the range. So this is one of the important things while building models, so that the model will not be biased. So these are the Metabo Analyst PCR results. 5 PCR principal components were shown here, out of which first one has a 19.6% of variance, and second one 16.7, and third one 6.5. Second one, right side one, is a scatter plot of PC2 versus PC1. And you can see that all the points lie in the 95% confidence level of both severe and non-severe, which means that none of them is outlier. Next. Is a volcano plot. The FC threshold parameter used is 2 and p-value threshold used is 1. There were 48 significantly upregulated proteins and 132 significantly downregulated proteins, and 477 proteins were insignificant. You can see examples of most regulated and upregulated and downregulated proteins in the graph. Heat map and correlation plot. I have used all the proteins in the heat map and correlation plot. This is because I don't want to filter out the best protein based on this. I want to use Orange as a software to give the best protein. So you can see that in the correlation plot, the only a single protein cannot, only a single protein cannot decide severity and non COVID severe or non-severe. it should be a bunch of proteins which can ultimately decide it. Orange workflow. This is the orange workflow I have used. So first CSV file import is the normalized data that is obtained from the Metabo analyst, and that was given to a Python script. Python script transposes the data so that samples come as x points and proteins come as in the y direction, in the columns. And I have added an extra column of name target with 0 for non-severe and 1 for severe for the TWT in the orange. The file shown is the output of the Python script, and that was given to PCA and scatter plot was taken. So this scatter plot will be similar to the above scatter plot used in Metabo analyst. Now this file is also given to RANK. RANK provides the best 10 proteins for the analysis. The scoring methods used were information gain ratio and Gini decrease. And then this reduced data is stored as a data table. And then this is given to different models. ML models used were random forest, neural networks, k-nearest neighbors, and support vector machine. All these models will learn a model and will be stored in the predictors. The test data is used the same as the training data. This because splitting of 21 samples leads to either less number of train data or less samples of test data. Either of which will be a bias thing. So I thought to go to all 21 samples of train data and all 21 samples of test data, which was also not a non-trivial task, which gave rise to these parameters, which could completely clarify all the points. In the case of random forest, number of trees used were 9, and number of attributes considered each bit were 5, and depth of each tree was 3. In the case of neural network, number of neurons was 20, activation was relay activation, and regularization factor is 0.0001. In the case of k-nearest neighbors algorithm, number of neighbors were 2, metric used was Manhattan distance, weight of each metric, which was proportional to distance. In the case of support vector machine, cost taken was 3, regression loss epsilon was taken to be 0.1, kernel used was polynomial kernel, with value of C and D given below are 1 and 3. The value of G will be automatic, it will be learned by the orange script. Now the top 10 proteins using RANK and other 10 proteins taken from volcano plot are combinedly taken to form a top 20 proteins from orange and metabolic. This is the confidence matrix used for all the 4 models. This is brought so that model is assumed to be correct. Now the above 20 proteins were used in spectrum analysis and which gave rise to 186 pathways, out of which top 40 pathways were shown here. Those 20 proteins were also used in string analysis, and this was the graph shown, out of which you can see 3 clusters, out of which first 2 clusters have having 5 proteins and the second and third cluster each having 2 proteins. First cluster was highly correlated with each other. At least at 4, you can observe that they are highly correlated with each other. And similarly, second cluster and third cluster. And there are few more proteins which are completely independent from the other proteins. So these are different pathways, and which are also found in literature on relation with COVID. So I have hyperlinked all the references to that pathway so that it would be easier for reading of the literature.
These were the references used.
All right, Ayappu Venkata, are you there?
Yes, sir.
All right, yeah. So let me set up a timer for you. So a good presentation, it was informative. Let the students and tea also keep asking questions in the chat parallel. Regarding the heat map when you showed in the beginning for the, trying to look at the patterns, correlation plots. What was that? Was that a supervised or unsupervised?
So it was unsupervised thing, sir.
Correct. So now once you have shortlisted based on your machine learning approach 20 proteins, did you again try to use that 20 combination and show that in the heat map for the unsupervised, how that will look now?
No, sir, I have not thought of it in that direction.
So that was the problem statement to begin with, right? That these are not making any cluster and one protein may not be the best classifier per se. That's why you need the bunch of panel protein, right?
Yes.
So ideally then one should take your proteins what you have identified and then try to again go back and see, can I now do the unsupervised clustering based on these 20 protein and see is that able to make two branches and show me the pattern, right? So that could have been tried.
Yes.
Nevertheless, among the top 20 protein, what are the top 3 proteins? Can you name those?
Maybe I'm not completely sure. According to the string analysis which I made, fibrinogen was a one strong protein.
Which no, not as, I mean, like, you know, when you did your looked at all the patterns possible, you know, from the orange output, then you selected 20 proteins. You have never shown me the name of all 20 proteins. Did you show that table for all the 20 proteins?
No, sir.
Yeah, so that should have been shown. No? Like, so because as a clinician or biologist, that will be the next thing from your analysis, what is coming out, right? So.
Yes.
Also, like, is 20 a good number to do a test? Think about yourself as a, let's say, a patient for some time. And if you are going for a testing and doctors are saying that 20 tests has to be done, whether 20 will be a decent number for testing or 3 or 5 will be a decent number for testing. So again, in the machine learning algorithm also, I think more the number, your accuracy model will be much higher. That is for sure. But if your smallest possible panel with the maximum accuracy, I think that's where all of you have to also keep in mind that what is my smallest possible panel could be 3, 5, 7, which can reach to, AC 95, 97, 98, may not be 100, but as close as possible. So those things have to be also keep in mind.
Yes.
From the pathway point of view, one of the top pathway came TLR or all like receptors. Do you know anything about them? What is the use of them?
Tried to search about it, sir, but I didn't understand. Most of them were not having any correlation with COVID.
Right, because COVID is not, there's no literature available too much on COVID, right? COVID is very new. But what we need to understand that in which way some of these pathways could be linked to the immune responses and could be linked to the, what you are, your problem statement is to look at the host response, which is changing from the mild to the severe form. And that's where I think, your findings should be also adding new knowledge to the community. And that's what, you do not want everything to be already known,
okay,
right? But then as a scientist working on the project, you'd also like make effort to understand why toll like receptor could be, but that's your top lead coming, as a main finding from your work. So why it is important and that could have a lot of clues and indications how disease is progressing from the mild to severe form. Okay, so these are some of the suggestions and points for you to look into it. I think that's all overall good effort made. Okay, let's move on to the next presenter now. Okay, so next presenter is Harshvardhan, and he's going to talk about Cushing's disease and going to compare that with control sample to identify the classifiers using machine learning approaches. Let's have this presentation now.
Hi and good morning, everyone. I'm Harshvardhan, fourth year BTech Computer Science and Engineering. Today I'm going to discuss about deep proteomics analysis of Cushing's versus control samples for identification of classifiers through machine learning approach. Introduction to Cushing syndrome. Cushing disease, pituitary adrenocorticotropin hormone, ACTH-dependent Cushing syndrome, produced by benign pituitary tumor, was first definitely described by Dr. Cushing in 1932. Cushing syndrome is a rare endocrine disorder with elevated cortisol levels in the blood over a long period of time. Cortisol is also called the stress hormone as it helps your body respond to stress. Cushing syndrome is most often seen in adults, more in women than in men. The ratio is about 3:1. Symptoms of Cushing syndrome include weight gain, thin arms and legs, round face, easy bruising and weak muscles. Children with this syndrome have obesity and grow slowly with when compared to others. Cushing syndrome can cause serious health problems like heart attack, high BP, memory loss, and type 2 diabetes. The most common cause of this syndrome is long-term or high-dose use of cortisol like glucocorticoids. In general, this is used by people for other medical conditions. And some people have this syndrome because their bodies make too much cortisol. Cushing syndrome can be hard to diagnose as weight gain and fatigue can be mistaken for other conditions that have many of the same signs. Diagnosis for this will be based on the person's medical history and based on tests. Some of the tests are 24-hour urinary free cortisol test, late night salivary cortisol test, low dose dexamethasone suppression test, LDDST, dexamethasone CRH test. Treatment for Cushing syndrome depends on the cause and may include surgery, chemotherapy, radiation, and cortisol reducing medicines. This is the workflow of my work. First, I have used MetaBoanalyst to analyze the data and to normalize it. Then I have written a Python script to convert the data into acceptable input for Orange Data Mining. I have used Orange Data Mining to analyze the data using machine learning models. Then I have selected some top features using Orange and MetaBoanalyst and then passed it on to String and Reactome. MetaBoanalyst analysis on the data set. Data integrity check. Samples are in columns and features are in rows. There are 35 samples by 4749 peaks data matrix. Samples are not paired and two groups are detected, Cushing's and control samples. There are a total of 0 missing values detected. Using MetaBoanalyst, I have done sample normalization by median and log transformation on the data set. Here we can see that the graph is as expected, like a Gaussian distribution. I got the score plot using principal component analysis. We can see there is an outlier here. I have also got the correlation heat map using MetaBoanalyst. Here we can see that the control samples, POS and ANT are the control samples which are highly correlated to each other. We can also see some Cushing samples which are correlated to each other, but control samples are highly correlated to each other when compared to Cushing's. This is the heat map which I obtained using MetaBoanalyst. Here we can see that some of the proteins have high values for control samples and low values for Cushing samples. And some of the proteins have high values for Cushing samples and low values for control samples. But here we can see that there is a diversity within the data samples. We can use this diversity to differentiate the samples into Cushing's or control samples. Instead of using all of the samples, you can use only some to differentiate. I have done t-test analysis using p-value threshold as 0.05. Here I obtained 981 significant and 3754 unsignificant. Fold change analysis using FC threshold equal to 2. Here I obtained significant up as 618, and significant down as 1364, and unsignificant as 2753. This is the volcano plot analysis using FC threshold equal to 2 and p-value threshold equal to 0.1 and group variance is unequal. Here I got 511 significant up and 791 significant down and 3433 unsignificant. Here we can see some top proteins. Also, these play major role. These can play major role to classify the samples. This is the workflow. This is the overall workflow which I have done in Orange. Here I gave a file as a normalized data with target as samples, Cushing's and control samples, and then I ranked the features using rank in Orange, which I have used the parameters as scoring methods, information gain ratio, and Gini decrease, and attributes I have taken top 15 ranked from overall. And then I passed it into data sampler. Here in the data sampler, we will have 35 instances and there are 35 samples. These are the parameters which I have used in data sampler. Sampling type is a fixed proportion of data, 70%. And data sample is the training data, 25 instances, and remaining data is 10 instances. Test data to test it. and then I passed it into 3 ML models, the neural network, K nearest neighbors, and SVM. And then I predicted the samples of the test data using the model predictors of these models. And then I got the confusion matrix. These are the parameters which I have used in ML models. In neural network, I have used 50 neurons in the hidden layer and activation as ReLU and solver as Adam, and maximum number of iterations equal to 100 and regularization alpha equal to 0.0001. This is the confusion matrix which I obtained in neural networks. Here of the 10 remaining data, 10 instances of the remaining data, two of them are zero. Here zero is control sample and one is Cushing sample, which I have given them, which I have indicated. So I'm getting, the model is predicting 0 as 0 and 1s as 1s. So I'm getting a total of correct values, correct one. In k nearest neighbors, I have used the parameter number of nearest neighbors equal to 5. Here also I'm getting a correct confusion matrix, I mean correct predictions. In support vector machine, SVM type equal to SVM, cost equal to 1, regression loss epsilon equal to 0.1, and kernel equal is RBF. Numerical tolerance is about, I gave it about 0.001, and iterations limit is equal to 100. Here also I got the same confusion matrix. I mean, that means the predictions are correct. Here are the 20 proteins which are taken from Orange and Metabo Analyst. From Orange, from the rank in Orange, which we have taken top 15, and from Metabo Analyst, I have used the volcano plot in which there are proteins in the top, and then I have formed the top 20 proteins. I have used these top 20 proteins in the string analysis and got this result. So there are a total of 16 edges. Here we can see that few proteins are strongly connected to each other, while few of them are not connected to any. This is the reactome pathway analysis, which I have used these 20 proteins into the reactome analysis. And I have got a total of 233 pathways. I have filtered them using p-value less than 0.05. And I have got 59 pathways. So I have listed them all. These are the few references which I have used to learn about Cushing syndrome. And thank you.
All right, Harshvardhan, are you there? Can we talk to you?
Yes.
Okay, all right. The timer starts now. So I think somewhere you mentioned about the fold change twofold and p value, but p value what you wrote was 0.1. Was that correct?
No, sir. I just realized it should have been 0.05.
Yeah, so then that actually questions the analysis, you know, because if the p value is insignificant, I thought it is error of 0.01 or something, or, you know, 001. Anyway, so please look into that part. Can you explain what was your rationale of choosing the test and training set for the number of sample which you chose?
It was just random. So I just took 25 for training and 10 to test it. In total of 35.
Right. So see, in that way, you can always do test on the, you know, small number. Let's say you can make random 10 batches, you know, a few samples, and you can do testing further. Even from the same pool of samples, you can make batch of samples which you can do testing, and again you can see your prediction accuracy from that. Next point is regarding the orange versus metabo analysis when you show top 20 proteins, right? Let's say from your orange based analysis you got top 15 or so protein which were looking good to you. How many of these were also as a VIP score protein from the metabo analyst?
Sir, I have not done the VIP score, but from the volcano plot, at least I think around 5-6 were matching from the top, and other 5 I took from little bottom ones from the volcano plot.
Yeah, so it will be good to highlight those as well, to also see, like, you know, a metabo analyst how much able to predict it on itself as a top proteins, right? Do you remember any of these top 3 or 5 proteins, what proteins you have, and any idea for?
Like, your, I don't remember the protein names.
And why they could
be the numbers which are on top end.
So at least out of curiosity, even if you're a computational person, still out of curiosity, you need to look at your top proteins are mapping to the, you know, making some possible predicted value, you know, for which you're looking at, right? So if top 5 protein, at least if you go literature quickly and just test out, you know, is there any relevance you're finding for pituitary in general, or looking for Cushing syndromes in particular, then I think that will add more confidence to your data, because sometime, you know, your models has to vary as per what you're finding as well, right? And also looking at, you have a large number of protein top 20, as I mentioned earlier as well. If you are looking at these protein, then you should also look at their performance based on their prediction, how good, if you can now use them for the unsupervised clustering. And also, why not try out even a smaller panel? Why to go with a such bigger panel? So these are the things to keep in mind. But my last question to you is the pathway analysis. So why you chose these top 20 protein for pathway analysis?
I think I did not want to take all the proteins, so I try to take some of the proteins. Then I thought of taking the top proteins from the rank from orange and from the volcano plot.
Right, but that gave you 230 some pathways, right? Which is
when I filtered with p value as 0.05, then I got only 59. In that NMD and UK, one more are like very much repeating.
Yeah, see, main thing is that for pathway analysis, when now there is more biology involved, right? The classifiers, machine learning, you want minimum numbers. Whereas for pathways, you want to understand where most of the biological changes are happening or clinical changes are happening. So that's where I think all the significant proteins should be taken forward when you talk about pathways. Within those pathways, then you can always try to map where your these top 20 proteins are going, like which in which pathways your these top 20 proteins are more, right? But making pathways only based on these top 20 may not be the best strategy understanding the overall disease biology per se, because you want to see maximum changes that are happening from the all the significant protein. Developing clinical tests can be based on the minimum number of protein, right? And that's where you have to still go much more lower than top 20 proteins. All right, that's all. So I think it was good informative presentation. Let's move on to the next presenter now.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, so next is going to be Basavaraju Jishnu is going to talk about Cushing's high grade meningitis. I think Cushing is probably some issues, or let me see what he has done the project, but meningioma high grade sample analysis using machine learning approaches. So let's listen to this presentation and clarify what the topic is exactly.
Hello, my name is Vishnu, and my project is deep proteomics analysis of Cushing stresses high grade meningioma samples for classifying them by identification of bioclassifiers, and I have used machine learning approach. So let's talk about meningiomas. Meningiomas are intracranial brain tumors which occur in meninges. Meninges are the membranes that envelope brain and spinal cord. Meningioma is the most common type of brain tumor. It primarily occurs around 40 to 70 years age demography, and it's more common in women than men. So more than 80% of meningiomas are low grade, which are low risk and can be treated easily. High grade meningiomas are difficult to cure and may be fatal. And with early diagnosis, meningiomas are easily curable. So these are the symptoms of meningioma. So there are some changes in vision, like diplopia and blurriness, and we get headaches due to intracranial pressure, which worsen in the morning. There is a hearing impairment or ringing of ears. Memory loss is also observed. Loss of smell is also observed. Focal seizures is also a symptom. Progressive spastic weakness in legs and speech impairment are also the symptoms of meningioma. These can be used to identify meningioma. So this is the WHO grading of meningiomas. So 80% of people have grade 1 meningiomas. 10 to 18% of people have grade 2, and 2 to 4% have grade 2 meningiomas. Grade 2 and grade 3 meningiomas are said to be high grade meningiomas. These are some statistics about meningiomas. So my project objective is meningiomas, if not identified in time, can be very problematic, in the sense that we need more aggressive methods to treat them, and they have higher possibility of relapsing. So for detecting meningiomas easily, we can use proteomics approach. So proteomics can be used to identify biomarkers to classify the high-grade meningiomas. So here we have done proteomics analysis of Cushing's disease samples versus high-grade meningioma samples to identify bioclassifiers. So this is the project workflow that I have followed. First, I have used MetaboAnalyst, and then I have used the MetaboAnalyst data in processed MetaboAnalyst data in Orange, and from the data I have obtained in Orange, I have taken some top proteins and have performed string and reactome analysis. So let's talk about the data set. So the data set contains 25 columns of Cushing samples and 11 columns of high grade meningioma samples. So the MetaboAnalyst data integrity check gave the following result. So there are 25.7% missing values were detected, and there are two groups, which is Cushing's and high grade meningioma, and there are in total 36 samples, which is 25 Cushing's and 11 high grade meningioma. So first, I have performed missing value imputation. I have removed features with more than 30% missing values, because I have already 5,500 plus features. So I have removed features with more than 30% missing values, and for remaining features, I have performed KNN feature wise to impute those missing values. And then we have to normalize the data. The data has been median normalized, normalized to a median for the adjustment of systematic difference samples. And then I have also performed the range scaling of the data for better visual understanding and comprehension of data. So this is how the data looks before and after normalization. As you can see, data is contained between -1 and 1 and 0 and 1. And this is the intensity and this is the normalization. So after performing this, I have obtained the correlation heat map. So this immediately gives that some proteins have high correlation with high grade meningioma samples, and some other proteins have high correlation with not as much as this, but high correlation with the Cushing samples. So this is a clear indication that proteomics approach can be used as a classifying approach for classifying these proteins and high grade meningioma samples. So with that, I have proceeded PLSDA. I have this to identify outliers. So I've got only 3 outliers, 2 in Cushing here and here, and 1 in high grade here. So I have proceeded without any removal of outliers. So this is the VIP score. From PLSDA, I have used the measure of importance VIP score. So this is the plot of VIP scores. This is the top 3 proteins with the VIP score, with respect to VIP scores. So I have noted down this protein. And then volcano plot showed that I have put the P threshold as 0.05. And I have just shown that 947 proteins are significantly upregulated and 92 proteins are significantly downregulated from the volcano plot. So then I have moved on to machine learning approach. So I have taken the normalized data from here and from this step, and I have used the machine learning approach. So I have used the orange for machine learning approach. So in orange, these VAP scores are calculated with the ANOVA measure. So in orange also, I have ranked the samples via ANOVA, and I have chosen the top 20 figures. And from this top 20 figures, I have used those figures to train and test machine learning models. Various machine learning models for identification of questions for high grade meningioma. So this is my orange workflow. As you see, from file, I have first ranked them according to ANOVA, and I have taken top 20 here. So then I have sent them into a data sampler. And from data sampler, I have sent them to neural network. These are the 4 approaches I have used: neural network, k nearest neighbors, support vector machine, SVM, and random forest. So, and I have taken test data from the data sampler to make prediction, and I have obtained the confusion matrix. So this is my orange workflow, and these are the 4 models that I have used. And now we'll see the result. From the results, I have got that all 4 models, the neural network, KNN, SVM, and random forest, all 4 are extremely effective in classifying or pushing for high grade samples. So here you can see precision and recall both are 1 and 1. With top 20 features, I am exactly able to qualify Cushing's and high grade meningioma samples with the machine learning approach. This proves that we can use this approach to efficiently classify the samples. This is the conclusion from here. So for the party analysis, I have taken the 20 top proteins from orange that I obtained from here, from this rank. And then I have took some other 5 proteins with 5 proteins with high VIP scores from the VIP scores plot I have shown before. So in total, there are 25 proteins which are considered for party analysis. So I have fed them into StringDB to get this result. As you can see, there are many proteins which are strongly correlated over here, and some other proteins which are very independent nodes. So strong correlation over here, so some maybe possibility of some interesting results in the next step. So then I have performed reactome analysis. This is the brief overview of reactome analysis. In reactome analysis, I have identified some significant pathways, acrophagy, selective autophagy, innate immune system, translation initiation, complex formation, iron uptake and transport, TRAF6 mediated IRF7 activation in TLR7/8 signal. These are the main pathways that I have identified and I have correlated with existing literature. So first is autophagy. Autophagy is a natural degradation of cell which will remove unnecessary components through lysosome dependent regulated mechanism. So this is responsible for degradation and recycling of cellular components. As you can see, I have found autophagy pathways. So this is already found in literature that it is related to brain tumors. So autophagy in cancers, including brain tumors, I have found the existing literature. And iron uptake and transport pathway. So as you can see here, I have found iron export and uptake and transport pathway. So cytoplasmic CD71 expression was largely negative in aneuploidomatous meningioma cases, but positive in meningococcal and high-grade meningiomas. These aneuploidomatous is low-grade meningiomas, suggesting that there is a transfer-independent iron transporter involved in iron uptake in meningioma. So that change was shown here. So as you can see, this is the literature that I have found correspond. And then translation initiation. So translation initiation is a complex process in which the tRNA initiator and 40S, 60S ribosomal units are assembled by eukaryotic initiation factory called EIF into ATS ribosomes with the initiation codon of mRNA. So this is already observed in literature, overexpression of EIF4F components in meningiomas and suppression of meningioma cell growth by inhibiting translation initiation. So I have found two pathways corresponding to that. This both are marked for purple. And for acrophagy, I have found two. Then innate immune system. So innate immune system is the immune system with which we are born, and it protects us against all antigens. So that keeps all harmful materials from entering our body. This is a first line of defensive immune response. So this identification of immune can also be correlated with the resistance pressure, risk of meningioma, and common variation genes related to innate immunity. So I have found the correlation with the common infection here. And finally, TRAC mutations. Tumor necrosis factor receptor associated factor TRAF proteins are key signaling molecules that function in various cellular signaling events. So this is the pathway that I have found, and I have correlated with the literature or genetic alterations of TRAF proteins in human cancers. So with that, I conclude. These are the conclusion remarks. So as you can see, proteomics analysis was extremely effective in classifying fusion process high-grade meningioma samples. And machine learning approach with top 20 features has classified the test data with near perfect accuracy. And our pathway analysis with the top proteins that I have found can be correlated with the existing published literature. So that I have concluded the presentation.
All right, Jishnu, are you there? Can we speak to you?
Hello.
Yes, sir. All right. So you try to compare, Cushing versus meningioma. So can you please, explain me again the question which you would like to address from this analysis?
Differentiation between Cushing's proteins and high-grade meningioma proteins.
Right. So as you probably have already understood that the, both of these are different type of you know diseases and cancer which we are talking, right? And so there is a already very high likelihood that it's going to have very differential responses, right? To because both of them are different type of diseases per se, right?
Yeah.
So and locations are very different as well, right? So with that context, you know, having 20 protein to classify for the two diseases, which is slightly disconnected, will be very broad panel. You know, so what could have been your strategy to narrow down the panel?
Yes, sir. Actually, in this class only, after you said that we need to take 20 samples for 20 proteins, I have opened Orange again and I have experimented.
Main thing is, software gives some output, right? Metabolist will give you some VIP score, 25 and 25 protein based on that, or Orange will give you 20 protein based on that. But as the you know student who's doing a project, you would like to take the best of those data and then take further, because I did not see anything from your predicted proteins, what you did to validate those proteins. Did you try any test data set to validate your findings?
No.
So that should have been tried, no? So you should have taken some random sample from both the groups, take your proteins and then try to validate those, your models, is that really working on the unknown samples, right?
Okay.
Yes, so that part was slightly lacking, but in terms of the significance of the study, I think you did make good effort of trying to learn the pathways and also give some rationale for that. In a box, like in that summary table, you have highlighted few boxes, you know, in some colors to show that these pathways are very important, which you're going to talk. For example, autophagy, you have talked, right? Now, these pathways, because we are talking about two different, you know, type of diseases, meningioma and Cushing.
Yeah.
So these pathways are in what context? Are you looking at just based on your top 25 protein, 20 plus 5, which you have added? And based on that, you're just looking at what is changing, or you are talking anything specific to what is so unique about meningioma, what is so unique about Cushing, and which is the best differentiator based on these pathways. So what was the autophagy, for example, will signify that? Can you explain that?
I have taken the pathways which are prominent in meningiomas only.
Right. So that's where I think you should have highlighted. And you can actually do the other way around as well. You can always take the pathways which are highly relevant in the right. Otherwise, that defeats the initial objective of comparing the two. Okay.
Yeah. While choosing those pathways, I have ensured that they have no correlation with Cushing's. I mean, I didn't mention, but while choosing the pathways, I have made that assumption. I mean, I have cross-checked that.
That's fine. So some of these points you can keep in mind, but I think overall you try to do best in possible to compare these two type of tumors.
Yeah.
All right, let's move on to the last presenter, Debarga Mitra, going to talk about global proteomic analysis of SVZ positive glioblastoma with SVZ negative glioblastoma samples using machine learning approaches to decipher the biological alteration. Debarga requested to make a live presentation given the some issues of uploading the video. So if you are there, Debarga, please go ahead and share your screen. Time is 15 sure. minutes. Yeah, given to you now, okay? Your slide is visible. As a presenter, you have to be visible as well.
Yes, sir.
All right.
Hello. Am I audible, sir? Good afternoon. So the topic, as you have already mentioned, sir, includes a global proteomic analysis of SVG positive glioblastoma and compared with the SVG negative glioblastoma samples through machine learning approach. So basically, starting with glioblastoma, what is glioblastoma? So as was discussed in the previous week also, so glioblastomas have been defined as grade 4 astrocytomas in a fast growing and aggressive brain tumor. It is not exactly common, but also not very rare of the tumors, and generally has a very grim prognosis. Analysis of transcriptomic data has associated glioblastomas to be clustered into four main subtypes: proneural, neural, classical, and mesenchymal. Below, I have included as to the variation across these four different subtypes of glioblastomas and how they vary across the entire, how they are prevalent across the different patients and their corresponding longevity. So moving on, since we have taken into consideration SVG cells containing glioblastoma and SVG cells not containing glioblastoma, so an introduction as to what could be, why SVG has been taken into consideration, because SVG in itself is normal fetal glial cells, and they in general do not have any, they generally are not used in association with the glioblastoma cells. So basically, in certain cases in elderly people, it has been detected that simian virus 40 has been implicated in the tumorigenesis of certain pituitary glioblastomas. And taking that into consideration, SVG-P12 cell line was established by transfecting cultured human fetal glial cells from the brain material dissected from, say, 8 to 12 weeks old embryos with DNA from an ORI mutant of SV40, as has been described in the paper below. So moving on, the data set includes the peak intensity data, followed by employing statistical methods through meta-analysis, followed by the pathway analysis of the obtained obtained samples through the corresponding filters. And in this case, I have employed the meta-analysis platform for random forest and SVU for determination of alterations. So the primary discussion as to what should be the cutoff percentage for the missing value filter, so as to ensure that the discrepancy in terms of the value of the missing values could be abrogated. So taking into consideration the 30% filter and 20% filter for the data set, which included around 14% of the values were missing. So at 20 and 30% filter were assessed through the PLSDA plot. And moving on with the 20% filter, I did not get a very accurate PCA plot for the same, as is visible from the entire overlap, which could be contributed to the dimensionality across the plot, and could be a result of overfitting. Apart from that, the PLSDA at 20% shows comparative association, and following which the VIP plots from the PLSDA assessment indicates several UniProt IDs of consecutive of subsequent proteins that could be observed. The subsequent heat map from the analysis indicates the scores in terms of a color, and indicates that the samples which had which are SVG positive glioblastoma, and which are SVG positive glioblastoma, and which are SVG negative glioblastoma are compared proportionately, as is evident from the clusters around. But again, there is heterogeneity in the scoring itself from the data. So the fold chain test and the ET test evaluates the number of samples which were significantly downregulated or upregulated, and based on that, around less than 100 proteins were significantly upregulated, and significantly around 90 90 such identifiers were identified, which were significantly downregulated from the full-stream test. So moving on to the pathway analysis. So the pathway analysis through the reactome and string was conducted, and the reactome data indicates the presence of L1 CAM and integrin cell surface proteins as to be highly upregulated. So apart from these top two contenders for the highly upregulated proteins, we find that there are several other UniProt identifiers which have been identified through the string and have been observed as upregulated pathways. And the other way around, I have taken into consideration the downregulated identifiers of UniProt that were identified through the reactome and placed them on string. So in either case, we find that markers for cytoskeleton movement have been present. However, in the upregulated pathways, they are mainly restricted to fimbrin proteins. And in certain cases, as I have already mentioned, L1 CAM and integrin cell surface proteins. Apart from that, in the downregulated pathways, we have come across that there are, the markers indicate other proteins such as spectrin, as in SPTBN, and plectrin, and also WIM proteins, which are associated with the angiogenesis in cancer cell lines. So trying to link the pathways which have been associated with glioblastoma and the upregulated proteins, we find that in a recent, not exactly recent, in a 2019 publication, ITGA2 has been identified as a potential target in glioblastoma, and ITGA2 is an anchoring protein which has been mentioned in the upregulated pathways to interact with integrin cell surface, to interact with lichens. So basically, these are the top regulated pathways in the data set itself and could be indicative of the data that we are looking at. Apart from that, L1 CAM interactions have also had a role in the proliferative action of NF-kappa-B in the pathogenesis of glioma. Apart from that, when it comes to glioblastoma cells, a lot of machine learning approaches have been utilized till date for identifying alterations across such cell types. So as I have mentioned, that there is a heterogeneous population comprising of four different types of glioblastomas, comprising of four different types of alterations across a transcriptomic scale in a glioblastoma cell. So associating such glioma stage predictions based on machine learning algorithms combined with the protein-protein interaction networks to help identify the stage of glioma as well as in the identification has been one such approach. And apart from that, the imaging and its corresponding correlation with genomics in glioblastoma has also been combined to identify suitable molecular and imaging signatures. One of the most recent review, this is based on a 2020 review paper. So they have suggested, that based on the existing SVM models and the existing random forest tutorials that people have been using, we find that in terms of glioblastoma, the deep neural networking has been found to be more accurate when it comes to identifying alterations across glioblastoma cells. However, once again, since this is based on already existing methods, it does not include any form of suggestions as to what could be used in the next decade. Apart from that, as I have mentioned, through the MetaBo analyst, the normalized data was analyzed based on the support vector machines and random forest. And in each case, as is apparent from the x-axis, so the random forest gives us the VIP plot through the random forest gives us a mean decrease in accuracy, and the frequency of the identified UniProt identifiers through the support vector machine is actually, both random forest and SVM are inversely reciprocal, as is apparent from the presence of the this QI3011, which is reciprocative of a carboxyl transferase protein and has also overlapped over SVN. So the suggestive conclusions that I was able to infer is that the identification of the data set based on the glioblastoma form suggests as to the tendency of pre-neural or neural blast-based glioblastoma cells. However, there could be sufficient overlap with classical glioblastoma cell patterns also. Mesenchymal cells would indicate some sort of epithelial markers, which in this case do not seem to be prominent. Moving on, we have suggested literature evidence of interaction between alpha and carry with the LCAM1, which are the top upregulated proteins in this case, indicating the markings of a pronounced glioblastoma cell line. Apart from that, the machine learning methods do show overlap to indicate possible proteins associated with the cellular framework. That is all from my side. Thank you, sir.
All right, well, so you have maintained the time well. In fact, you're 3 minutes less that can be used for the question answer now. So did you make any effort, Divargya, to talk to the TAs or myself to understand this problem first? You know, like, what is the problem which we are talking, SVZ problem? Did you clarify this thing in any of the help session, or you just went ahead with your understanding of this problem?
Sir, I assume SVG refers to the cell line itself, so I went ahead across that.
Right. I think it's important for you and others also to make sure that when we are giving some help session and clarification time, utilize that to clarify that, what, you know, if you have something else to clarify from our side. Main thing is, in this context, you have totally misunderstood the problem itself. Therefore, while your approaches are correct, what we should do for analysis, but the problem statement itself is wrong to understand. Therefore, rest of the discussion was, at least for me, was looking little off. SVZ ideally is subventricular zone region in the brain, okay, which is depicts the location of the tumor. So when the neurosurgeons, they do the surgery, and before that they do radiology images to map which location the tumor is, right? So they look at, okay, if the tumor is very close to the SVZ region, these tumors are very aggressive, they are going to infiltrate much faster, and therefore they're more aggressive. Whereas some tumors are slightly far off from the SVZ region, those are actually less aggressive. Okay, now what we are talking about, same tumor type, GBM, as you already mentioned, there are different types of glioma tumors. Within that, glioblastoma is the highest grade, grade 4 malignant type of tumor. Now, what your problem was to compare the heterogeneity of the glioblastoma tumor. It means the same tumor, how that behaves when the tumor is close to the SVZ region or tumor is slightly far off from the SVZ region. Okay, so therefore, when the problem statement is misunderstood, then rest of the conclusions actually will be in that regard will be not in the right sync. While the approach could still be okay, what you identified the proteins, right? So for example, now L1 CAM, which one of the protein which you identified, that may still be valid and interesting. Now, only thing is, you have to think in the context of heterogeneity of tumor. What is the role of this protein or the function of this protein in context of the heterogeneity of glioblastoma tumor? Whether the upregulation of this tumor is going to some way help the patient, or is that going to be more detrimental for the patient, you know, for the aggressiveness or for the, you know, better survival?
Because I believe, based on the literature,
yeah,
the more the heterogeneous is the population, the more grim is the prognosis.
Correct. So these are GBMs. Yeah, GBM grade 4 are already very heterogeneous tumor. That is already known fact. And within those, you are looking at two subpopulations for heterogeneity. Now, what will be role of this protein L1 CAM, for example? Whether this protein could be important to predict the aggressiveness of tumor or recurrence of tumor or possible improvement in the tumor. What will be your understanding for this protein? Can you explain?
Based on the existence of LCAM1 and the down regulation of VIM in our, I mean, based on the data set. So there is an upregulation of LCAM1, but we have a down regulated of angiogenesis factors itself. So that could actually play in favor of
the SVZ population, right?
Yes, sir.
So you should think in that context now that L1 CAM is upregulated in the SVZ positive, which is more aggressive tumor. So this could be an indicator of aggressiveness of the tumor.
Yes, right? That is suggestive of how the, I mean, due to the abundance of LCAM1, that could suggest as to the abundance of the interactions with the integrin proteins, which has been selected as a target also.
Right, and likewise, if something is down in the SVZ positive, that is upregulated in the SVZ negative, right? So then those could be good markers, you know, these tumors are going to behave better or they are going to be less aggressive. So one need to think, you know, the findings in context of the problem statement. Otherwise, I think approaches what you showed was fine. But I thought you will actually come up with some panel which can differentiate the SVZ positive versus negative, and then you will talk in the context of heterogeneity, how that is useful. Okay, so don't miss out the help session, students. If at all any doubts you have or you want to clarify the problems, please do talk to us so that we can add you some biology or clinical detail behind these problems that will help you interpret your data better. Whatever commercial approach you take, your thought process will only revolve better if you know the problems better, right? All right, so let's thank all the presenters for today. They made good presentation, understand the problems well, tried to add up some new findings based on their projects. And finally, let me remind two things. One is the next presentation due on Friday. Please upload your presentation by tomorrow evening or night. Understand that, you know, given the short timing what we have for the class, we want everything, every time to be utilized without any breaking the voice and any issues happening. So it will be best to have those videos available to us before time. Assignments, please make sure that you are doing it well, the writing part, don't take it superficial. Also think about the philosophy of why we are doing some of these things to improve your overall, not only knowing the tools and techniques and softwares and instruments, but also your overall way of improvement for your you know, scientific communication, how to present your data, how to discuss your data, how to write your data. So those things will be very important as well. So please do write better summary for the assignments. Finally, some of the students who have missed out the presentations, previous presentations, due to several reasons which you are stating in the emails to me, please record your presentations and be ready. Maybe in the last presentation slot, which will be after two classes from now, we will give you a slot to make presentations. And that will be the last time an opportunity, because after that, we don't have much time before NSEM. So, you know, if you don't make even effort now, then it will be totally zero marks. But still, you have to provide the valid reason why you missed the previous presentation slot. All right, that's all for the day now. Let's meet again on Friday, and we'll be looking forward for more exciting presentation from the next set of students. Thank you, everyone.